Good morning and happy Sunday. It's Palm Sunday. It might not feel like that today. Things are really weird this year. We've all been sent to our rooms. And this is such a hard time for our world right now, which makes the hope of Easter and Palm Sunday to me stand out all the more. And so Easter, Palm Sunday, we're still celebrating those. Amen. And so this morning we're reading in the book of Job on Palm Sunday. But that's all right, there's some good stuff in here. I also want to just say before I read, because I keep forgetting to say this, I'm going to put a link on today's post after I finish recording about Hope Reinvented, a devotional study that we're going to be doing in a Facebook group. And I have four small group leaders who are going to be leading that over this coming month here that we're in. And we're going to kick it off on Monday night. But on the link, you just go ahead and fill out the form, you join our group, and I'm going to provide free resources, digital resources, have community talking about the hope that God has for us. But that's a good topic to say before we dive into Job, right? All right, we're in chapters 27 and 28, and Job kicks off today's reading with an accusation against God. We've seen this before, but it says, "As God lives, who has deprived me of justice, and the Almighty who has made me bitter, as long as my breath is still in me and the breath from God remains in my nostrils, my lips will not speak unjustly, and my tongue will not utter deceit. I will never affirm that you are right. I will maintain my integrity until I die. I will cling to my righteousness and never let it go. My conscience will not accuse me as long as I live." So Job blames God for his suffering. We've all felt this from time to time. We don't understand why we have to suffer. This is a fallen world, but what we don't do is we often don't question ourselves. We question God instead. That's our flesh. Because there's this humanism pervasive in our society, there's this entitlement feeling we deserve blessing. But really, we should question ourselves, examine our own thoughts. Because just because we think something does not make it true. Amen. But what is interesting in this passage is that Job is correct in verse 5. His friends are not right in accusing Job either. Job wasn't right in accusing God. But in verse 6, Job refuses to give in to condemnation, kind of reminiscent of Romans 8:1 there. So yesterday in Psalm 34, verses 11 through 14, we were learning that the fear of God is to keep our tongue from evil, to not speak deceit with our tongues. Job just mentioned that. He says, "I'm not going to do those things." So Job rightly says that there is no hope for the wicked, also in verse 8. So there's some truth that Job is sharing. I think the conflict we have sometimes with suffering is if we question God, instead of submitting to him in that suffering and saying, "God, I don't understand this, but I know you're Lord, and I want to know you. I want to please you, even in this." There's just a different attitude there. But in Job 28, Job writes a poem about wisdom, which I think is really good. And this is where our scripture verses from the day come from. And it's actually Job 28, verses 12 and 13 and 23 and 28. So I'm not doing the whole passage, just picking the key verses that stood out to me. "But do people know where to find wisdom? Where can they find understanding? No one knows where to find it. For it is not found among the living. God alone understands the way to wisdom. He knows where it can be found. And this is what he says to all humanity. The fear of the Lord is true wisdom. To forsake evil is real understanding." So here we have this again, right? Yesterday in Psalms, learning the same thing. Here we're going to go a little bit deeper. This is a little bit from a commentary this morning about the fear of the Lord and wisdom. So, how is the fear of the Lord the beginning of wisdom? Proverbs 9:10 says that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. Basically, this verse teaches that the fear of God is foundational to true wisdom. All other types of learning are worthless unless built upon a knowledge of the Lord himself. Many other passages talk about the fear of the Lord. Psalm 111 verse 10, Proverbs 1 verse 7, 14 verse 27, and Proverbs 15 verse 33. So Proverbs 1 verse 7 has been my email address, part of my email address for, I don't know, 2 decades. Because the fear of the Lord was something early on in my walk and the seeking of wisdom that I desperately knew I needed. In fact, with my children, we would do devotions when they were young about finding wisdom, and it was the study on Proverbs, and I encouraged my kids, pursue wisdom, pursue God, fear God. Good morning, Larry, how are you doing? So in the Bible, the word translated fear can mean several things. And we need to understand what fear means to be able to understand what the fear of the Lord means. It can refer to terror one feels in a frightening situation, like Deuteronomy 2:25. Hey, Pat, good to see you. I hope you're well, friend. It can refer to respect. Fear can also denote the reverence or awe a person feels in the presence of greatness. The fear of the Lord is a combination of all of these. So I've talked about before that it isn't necessarily the fear of the Lord shaking in our boots, but there is that element because we realize we're accountable to a holy God and we're not holy, and that's a problem. And so the fear of the Lord incorporates that. The fear of the Lord can be defined as the continual awareness that our loving Heavenly Father is watching and evaluating everything we think, say, and do. Ooh, that's humbling. I think we all have those things in our life that we say, I'm sorry, God, for. I mean, hopefully we've all repented and come to that place of seeing our need of God's forgiveness. That's part of the fear of the Lord. The link between the fear of God and wisdom means we cannot possess wisdom if we recreate God in our own image. Too many people want to tame God into a non-threatening nobody. But if we redefine the Lord as a God that makes us feel comfortable, a permissive buddy who exists simply to bless us and give us what we want, we will not fear him in the way he deserves to be feared. The Lord God Almighty is far greater than that. And the fear of the Lord begins when we see him in his majesty and power. So this was some really good things that I found on a commentary this morning. And really, until our hearts are in a right relationship with God, which is where we've come to that place of understanding that we are sinners and we need forgiveness from a holy God because he set the perfect law for us to obey, which we never could. The law revealed our need of God, didn't it? And so at that place where we feel completely desperate, we can come before a holy God and ask for his forgiveness. And the fear of God means I'm going to be aware of his presence. I'm going to practice the presence of God in my life. I'm going to acknowledge God. Look what God has done in my life. I'm not going to take the glory. It's God's. He chose me. He saved me. And he did the same for you. So the fear of God helps us to be in a right relationship with him. It means we acknowledge him and we're aware of his presence. I surrender to him as Lord and I obey him. It means I cannot continue in sin because I know I am accountable to him. He sees everything. Good morning, Penny and Patricia and Kathy. Good to see you guys. As it says in our scripture verse of the day, I want to read that again. But do people know where to find wisdom? Where can they find understanding? No one knows where to find it, for it is not found among the living. God alone understands the way to wisdom. He knows where it can be found. And this is where he says to all humanity, the fear of the Lord is true wisdom. To forsake evil is real understanding. Hey there, Rebecca. You know, when my children were little, I shared that I used to read a devotion to them. But one thing I realized was I could ask for wisdom for my kids. I could pray to God for that. But ultimately, each person has got to seek wisdom on their own. They've got to see their need of wisdom to get wisdom. Does that make sense? And so we have a problem in this world. Like there's been times where I'm like, oh God, I don't know what to do. And right there we see in James 1:5, he says, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God who gives generously to all without finding fault. wow. I may have shared this on you before, I'm not sure, but when my oldest was about a year old or maybe 8 months old, an encyclopedia salesman came to our door and said, if you'll buy this set of encyclopedias, any three questions you want answered, I will get the answer for you. You can ask them whatever, whenever you want. I bought the books for that reason. That's because I'm a nerd. Anyway, I was like, oh, any three questions. And you know, I never asked the questions. It's a sad truth, but it's true. But there's this desire in us. We want to know wisdom, but sometimes we just don't seek it. And God is the only place we can find it. Now we live in the day of Google, y'all. We can Google just about anything. But true wisdom isn't even found on Google. Unless Google says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So God is inviting us today to come seek Him, to come know Him. And so for us to have this fear of the Lord that Job is talking about as the beginning of wisdom, we've got to recognize our need of God. So I don't know where you're at today, but I know God loves you. I know He's inviting you to come and know Him. So if you need to repent, I'm just going to pray a prayer with you real quick, and then I'm going to head to church. Lord God, we just lift up everybody listening today, God. If there are some who don't know You, Lord, I just pray right now in Jesus' name that You would open their eyes to understand and know Your goodness, Lord. Our flesh accuses You, and You're holy and righteous and good. Forgive us for that, God, and help us to know You and walk in Your wisdom, Lord. Not just know about wisdom, but to walk in wisdom because we fear and know You. In Jesus' name, amen. Happy Palm Sunday, y'all. And I'm going to put that link for the Hope Reinvented Bible Study. I hope you'll join me. It's free, and all the resources are free. I just want to encourage people during this time, and there's four small group leaders who are going to help guide that. You guys, go with God, and Lord willing, I'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.